is writing this letter to Philippi, and he began to talk about them being deceived. You know, he talks about them not, falling to these false teachers that are coming into play. He calls them dogs, and he tells them that people who want to do evil. And then there's a word, if you look, and he's talking about the science of them, or the mutilating of these people. And he starts talking about people doing stuff on their own power, or the success of themselves, you know, how they boast about or brag about the stuff they got. And then Paul says, if anybody is going to brag, I should be the one who brags. Mm-hmm. He says, I'm from good stock. And he starts talking about the tribe of Benjamin, who produced the first king of Israel, who Benjamin and Judah was the only two tribes in the book of Ezra that came back out of exile and restarted Israel again. He said, if somebody gonna brag, it's me. I have a lineage of, I am a Hebrew of Hebrews. Ain't nobody like me, he's saying. He said, then even though I'm a Hebrew of Hebrews, I'm a Pharisee. That means I'm taught well. I have a well understanding of the word and the law. And not only that, I have followed the law to a T. In so much, I prosecuted Christians and brought them into Paul saying all of this stuff. And then all of a sudden he says, but you know what? I count all that dung. It's nothing to me. It's crap. It don't mean nothing. He says, because this is the thing. The thing about me is I want to get closer. I want to look like the one who apprehended me, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
He's saying his whole meaning, his whole earthly ministry is about having the appearance of Christ.
Mm.
I'm going to pause right here and have a quick sidebar. I'm just going to sidebar real quick. It's funny to me, Peter and Paul had two different ministries. Peter had a ministry that was to devout Jews. Peter preached to the Jews. If there was a preacher for the Jews, it was Peter. And then there was a preacher to the Gentiles, the one who we would be. He was sent out to talk to the people who wasn't Jews. It was Paul.
Still.
They had this dispute and get into an argument and almost split stuff all the way up because of their dispute. And it's funny, Paul, who was the Pharisees, Peter wasn't the learned one, but he was sent to the Jews. Paul was the learned one, he was sent to the Gentiles. And in all of that, Paul is desiring to look like Christ.
Mm.
Paul is the one saying, I want me to be remembered as one who resembles Christ. But Peter was the one who got that accolade, and he ain't even won.
Mm-hmm.
Remember when Jesus was at the cross, and Peter came, and he wanted to see what was going on with Jesus, and he's sitting by the fire, you know, he's just trying to get a look and see what's going on with the whole thing, and little girl, you know, it's always one little kid that, you know, you don't really want to talk to, but they're going to bust you out anyway. It's always one of them. So he by the fire trying to be nosy, seeing what's going on with Jesus. Little girl say, Peter, hey, you one of them men that was with Jesus. He said, no, go on now. Little girl said, yes, you were. You look like him. You even talk like him. Man, you was with him. And he was upset. He was so upset, he started cussing the little girl out for telling him he looked like Jesus.
Mm, right.
And here Paul is saying, all of my ministry, all of my being, I want to look and sound like him. That's my quick sidebar. It's just ironic to me that these two preachers, even though they're in the same set, one of them is desiring to look exactly like the Messiah. The other one was mad because he was identified to look like the Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
All right, I'm done that one, boy. I'm going to come from the sidebar because y'all ain't even interested in that. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
So here Paul is, and Paul starts talking about him pressing toward the mark. Now, if you have your bulletin, it'll tell you what the sermon is about. It says, do you have enough in you to press? Do you have enough in you to press? Years ago, I taught my nephews, I was coaching his basketball team, and he played for the school St. Thomas, and they were a Catholic school in the diocese. And the first year I came on, I was just supposed to be a helper to the coach, but somehow I ended up coaching the team. And once I took over as head coach, I decided that the team didn't have no press, Thomas. They didn't have no press. I said, we need to inject that into our strategy, our game plan. We need to press. So the very next game, soon as tip-off came, I had my boys in the press. And the referee said, timeout. He came to the side. He said, coach, you can't have your boys press in the beginning of the game. You have to wait to the second quarter in order for them to press. I said, okay. But by the second quarter, folks get winded. By the second quarter, you don't have enough in you. By the second quarter, you have to be conditioned to be able to press. Mm-hmm. And it's just like that in your life. What happens when all of your success means nothing? Mm-hmm. What happens when your natural abilities won't get you there? What happens when you have nothing left in the tank, when you have enough in you to press?
Amen.
See, that's how life is set up. Life is set up not a series of you just winning. It is set up of a series of things that happen that you must take control of.
Mm-hmm.
See, it ain't ever going to be just lollipop and roses just because you're in the kingdom.
Amen.
It's not just that. You have things that you have to get over. There's a hump you have to get over. There's some obstacles that come into play. It is not one team on the field, people. I hate to tell you that. Sometimes y'all think y'all the only team on the field, but the enemy got a team too.
Yeah.
All right now.
And he's ready to press. He's conditioned them that in the late hours of the game that they have to be ready for the things that's going on. But are you ready in the late hours of the game to press?
Mm.
See, Paul says you must be perfect. And when he said that, I can see I lost most of y'all. Because y'all think, I'll never be perfect. That's not me. I'm going to make mistakes. But that's not what he's saying there. What he's actually saying is you must be mature.
Yeah.
You must be mature in the things that you're doing of God. See, what happens with somebody who is a novice, that means that they're new onto something. They can be pushing all along, but when they face an obstacle, all of a sudden, all the air is let out of the balloon. You don't have enough in you to get over the hump. But when you are mature in God and all of a sudden an obstacle comes into play, you know it's not your mountain to move.
Mm. Amen.
See, it has to be you depending on the Holy Ghost to get you over the hump. And you have to know when to tag in the Holy Ghost to come into play for you when you don't have enough steam for you.
Amen.
We watched the movie the other day. It was called War Room. In this movie, it was this older lady teaching this younger lady how to fight correctly.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure some of the ladies in the audience, when they first heard that, said, we're going to get him talking about their husband because it was a problem with the marriage. But it wasn't that what she was showing her. She wasn't showing her how to combat him.
Yes.
She wasn't showing her how to come on the offense of him. She wasn't showing her how to tear him down. She was showing her how to go into a place with God where things ain't right and you close yourself off.
Yes.
And all of a sudden your personal relationship gets strengthened. And when that personal relationship gets strengthened, it's no longer you fighting that battle.
Yes.
That's how you press. You press by getting into that place with God. There's nobody but you and him. And I don't care how you do it, on your knees, on your face, hands lifted up, but you got something going with God.
Yeah.
And so much that while you in that closet, he's out on the outside moving things around, switching things, putting things into place for your good.
That's right.
That's how you press.
Yes.
That's right.
Amen.
That's right. See, we get it confused. When Paul is talking about this, he said, it is not something for you to do who's mature. Then he said, if you're not mature, he said, then God will explain it to you anyway. What he's saying, I used to hear old men say, God take care of babies and fools.
Yeah.
Anyway, you heard that before. I'm glad somebody else heard that. God take care of babies and fools. Yeah. And that's what Paul is saying. If you simple-minded and you can't figure it out, that God is the one working on your behalf, just wait a second. He'll show you it's him too. It don't have to be no hard thing for you. God is saying no matter where you are in your intelligence, mm-hmm. where you are in your maturity, I'm going to show you that I show up when it's time to fight.
Yes. Amen.
How many of you had a cousin that you was always going to go get when it was time to fight? When it was time to fight. You make sure Ray Ray was there. Hold on. Let me get Ray Ray because it's about to jump off. You don't need Ray Ray for this.
Yeah.
You need Earl
All right.
in there. You don't need Biggs. You don't need Robert Ed. You don't need none of them when it's time to get down and dirty. All you need to do is learn how to press.
Yeah.
Place with God. Fall on your knees.
Yeah.
Surrender
Amen.
To him. And he'll bring this thing back to you.
Yes.
Some of y'all been taking L's for far too long.
Amen.
Every time I turn around, I'm taking an L. I can't do it no more, God. I'm ready for my victory. I'm ready to stand with my hands held high.
That's
I'm
right.
ready to be the last man standing. Yeah. But if you want to be that person, go into your prayer closet.
That's
I'm
right.
Feeling that thing correctly. And when you walk out and God has laid everybody else down, mm-hmm. you can be the last man standing that time.
Yeah.
It's Amen. That time for us.
All right.
I'm tired of fighting for nothing.
Yeah.
I'm tired of not having a strategy.
Right.
Paul's giving this to us. I said, Lord, I've been reading this all week and then my father, he said, man, listen, whatever you do, go see that movie. Take your kids to the movie. You know what I mean? I said, that's what I'm going to do. I called my sister. I said, sis, I'm going to get this movie. She said, that sounds like you wanted to me. And I said, let me call my mother-in-law. And I said, let me call my own mama. That's all good. We all went to go see this movie. See, because this is how it is in God. God don't want one person to win.
Yeah.
He want all of us to win. He want all of us to see the plan. He want all of us to know where we're supposed to be strategically placed. When you get things aligned up, you remember that game Battleship? See, you always had layers of little ships and midships to protect one ship. It didn't matter of all these ships if I could just sink your battleship. But what you did was you had layers of people on the attack, and the battleship was navigating behind those forces. Well, I'm telling you, you need to be the battleship and let God be all those, that navy in front of you, pressing forward.
Yeah, amen.
Amen.
That's right. That's right.
Thank you, Lord.
Paul didn't want people, he said, the King James will confuse you when you read it. He said, I did all this weeping.
Mm-hmm.
When you read it in the NLT, he said, with tears in my eyes, he's begging you. He's begging you with tears in his eyes to say, just follow God in this. All you have to do is come into this place with God that he moves on your behalf.
Yeah.
It's something when you're talking to someone. Have you ever just prayed with somebody and when you pray you don't know what you're saying, but that person has been going through hell and God has given you all the words to say to them, and as you're saying these words to them, you can see the tears welling up in their eyes because they have been through this mess. Paul was saying with tears in his eyes, I'm sincere about what God has said to me about you. Follow me in
yes.
this. Follow me in this
right.
journey so that you can get the best out of your eyes. outcome.
Amen.
Everybody miss it when they say I'm gonna press toward the mark. We always miss it. What's the mark? That's the question. What's the mark? Nobody really knows. You know why nobody really knows? Because God has given us each individually our own calling.
Amen.
So while you're looking for Thomas's mark, you're missing it all the time because he's the only one that can hit that mark. We're too busy trying to line up with somebody else's church. Their church don't do that. They got 1,000 members and they ain't doing that. I don't care what they doing. We got 5 members and we ain't gonna do it. You know why? Because our mark is different. The calling on this church ain't gonna be the same one over there. And until we line up to what God is saying and forget about Deacon so-and-so down there and Bishop so-and-so over there, we always gonna miss the mark. But when you get into that place with God and you can recognize where the high calling is for you, when you start hitting the mark, all of a sudden that 5 has grown to 50 and that 50 to 500, because when they see you hitting, they want to be in the place that you're in.
That's right. Amen. Amen.
Preaching harder than I
today. Amen. It's all right.
It's all right.
But it's something about this message.
Yes.
It's something about your personal mark that you have to get. It's something about you lining yourself up. It's not my job to entertain you up here preaching. It's my job to get you in your personal relationship where it needs to be with God in order for this church to be successful. Why do we want this church to be successful? Not because we're here, but because God has called it. He has ordained it to be so. When we can start finding that place. See, when Paul says, follow me in it, he's not saying follow him, Paul. He's saying follow the office of this apostle and get into alignment with God. See, one of the things apostles did was they set up churches, built them, put a foundation on them, and moved on to the next. He said, follow me in that example, where you can build up your local assembly where you are. How do you do that? By doing what you're called to do. All y'all ain't called to preach. It might look good. But when your mouth is dry up here like mine is, it ain't going to be the same. It might sound good. But when you ain't got the words to say, it ain't good. It might say, this is what it's supposed to be. No. It is whatever God has called you to do. It might just be smiling at the door saying, thank you for coming.
Amen.
That's what it is.
Amen.
But Paul says this too. He said, forgetting the things behind you. See, that's our problem. We get onto task and all of a sudden we remember the things behind us.
Mm-hmm.
I remember my niece had her first birthday and my nephew was there. He said, I'm with y'all. I'm playing football. I run the ball. He don't even know the position. He just know he run the ball. He said, I run the ball. I said, did you score a touchdown? He said, I almost did. So I asked number one. I said, number one, what happened? Number one said, he almost was there, but he kept looking back at the guy behind him, and he called him, that's y'all. See, God has called you forward, but you keep looking back because you can feel the enemy chasing you. But if you quit looking back, because there's a scripture in Luke 9, 61, 62, when Jesus said, if you put your hands to the plow, if you look back, you're not fit for the kingdom.
Amen.
I didn't say Paul said that. I didn't say Peter said that. I didn't say Matthew and John said that. I said Jesus said, if you have your hands on the plow and the plow is moving, if you look back, the kingdom ain't for you. Why does he say that? He said he don't want nobody who's scared of what's in front of them.
Amen.
See, it's important for you to understand that the windshield is always bigger than the back window.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Why is the windshield always bigger than the back window? Because what God has for you is bigger than you even imagine.
All right, keep your head forward, looking for it.
Even if it's dark, see, even if it's dark, God will swing the light for you in order to see your next step. You ain't got to see what's going on. They get pulled into the Damascus block.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody had to take him by his hand and lead him there, but his destiny was still there. All you have to do, if you can't see, is listen. See, some of us can't listen. Shout out long enough. I got a sister. I ain't gonna say which one of them. I got four. Okay, pick it out yourself. I got a sister. But even when she called me, I know I got 5 minutes max or minimum on the phone. I can't even say nothing. Charles, guess what? Such and such said this, and then this happened. And then such and such said this. I ain't said nothing yet. I'm on the phone for such and such minutes. My wife will look over and say, oh, that's your sister. Because she know that this person gonna keep going. See, that's how you are. But if you shut your mouth long enough for God to say something back to you, and it gets you on course for your prize.
Amen.
Amen.
Paul said this about this. He said, we are heavenly citizens.
Mm-hmm.
He said this conversation is in heaven. What that mean? What does that mean, Thomas? If the conversation is in heaven, what does that mean? What does that mean for me, huh? Can't nobody figure that out? If the conversation in heaven, that means you're in heaven.
Amen.
Speaking about it. See, God said, I'll put you in heavenly places. Even though you down on earth, he got you seated at the same time in heavenly places with the Messiah. So while you down here, don't run your mouth about meaningless things. Think about that conversation that you're having up in heaven with the Messiah. Yeah. See, that's what's going to get you to the next mark.
Amen.
I can't think of the scripture right now, but it was talking about Jesus. And Jesus was talking about him who ascended into heaven, being on earth and in heaven at the same time. He was talking about himself. He's talking about him being on earth, and when he ascends in heaven, what he's going to do, and while he's in heaven at the right hand of the Father, what he's doing at that time. There's three different things going on. But guess what you're worried about? You're worried about what's happening at work. Mm-hmm. You're worried about what your cousin said to you. You're worried about Auntie Jane and her church people pedophiles ain't never what they was. Mm-hmm. No more. That's what you're worried about. That's your conversation. But it's heavenly things going on up there. Yeah. And if you can just lay hold to that, you can't reach heaven down here worried about what these suckers is doing.
That's right.
Now, excuse me, I'm going to hope that I'm misunderstanding. You can't reach heaven worried about what these unbelievers are doing. You can't reach heaven in your mind. But see, you know, it's not just your mind. I'm going to sum it all up because I know somebody got that chicken grease open. I know it's all. I'm going to sum it all up in 21, it says, who shall change our vile body? I talked about this last week. I'm going to sum it all up with this. This is that may be fashioned like unto his glorious body. I'm going to talk about this in 1 second. Hold on. Give me a second. According to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself.
Well,
now, I'm going to break it down slow for you. Real slow for you. He says, who shall change our vile bodies? Last week I told you, when you confess with your mouth, what's in your heart, the belief is in your heart, at that moment, your inner man is saved. That's your spirit, man.
Mm-hmm.
People think your soul and your spirit is the same thing, not so. That saved. Then you're working on getting your soul saved. Your soul is your mind, your thought process, how you do things, your MO, modus operandi, right? That's what that is. Your soul is this, your thinking process, your pattern. When your spirit is saved, it starts working on your soul to get it saved. But the very last thing to be saved is your body. And that's where that last scripture comes into play. He said, your vile body. Mm. That's when you reach heaven, your vile body gets saved. And then you get that new body. Remember when Jesus walks into the building with the locked door with the disciples and they were spooked, and Thomas said, not this Thomas, because he was a believer. He said, man, if that Jesus, if that's really you, let me see your hands and let me look into your side.
Right, right.
See, that's some of us. Jesus done walk through the door. Mm. The door is locked. Yes. He done walk in your door and you still say, let me look at your hands.
Right.
Let me see your side, because you don't believe enough in the Messiah when he show up on your behalf. But nevertheless, he shows him this stuff.
Amen.
Why? So his soul can get it. So his soul can fall into place with the inner man. Now them two is locked. And Jesus said, when you come in, his body was already changed. When we get to heaven, our body changes. See, I lost a couple pounds. Ave done lost weight. You could look at her and see it. But that's still, as good as she looked right there, as good as I look, I done dropped some pounds. If y'all ain't gonna say I look good, I'm gonna say it. But if you don't believe it, I done dropped some pounds. But even though I done dropped these pounds, this ain't my divine body. When the divine body comes, I'm gonna have that six pack Natalie looking for. Let's bring it back. But that's my divine body, which is exactly glorious, like God had designed it to look like. That's what it is. It says that he can make all these things subdue unto himself. Why? Because it has to click with scripture. And the other scripture said, all things was made through him, all things was made by him.
Yeah.
So if all things is made through him and all things was made by him, he has the right and the authority to bring all of that stuff into subjection. And what I'm saying to you now is don't make him call you into subjection. Surrender yourself.
Amen.
I done said all this stuff about pressing. But if you can't surrender yourself to God, you'll never be able to press.
Yeah.
He has to have all of you to work on your behalf.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
He has to have all of them
mm-hmm.
to work on your behalf. God is saying, in this hour, it's time to press.
Yes.
And it's time to press. When 9-year-old boys is getting shot in Chicago.
Oh, geez.
It's time to press. When cops is coming and slamming little girls on their head in the classroom, it's time to press.
Yeah.
When your wife ain't coming home at night,
it's time to press.
It's time to press. If you got more double cheeseburgers than you ought to. It's time to press. Wherever you are in life, you have to know when it's that time.
Yes.
Amen.
Like that ref told me when I was a young coach, you can only press in the second half. God is telling you exactly when to press. But if you're not available for him, if your ears aren't open unto him, you'll miss the memo, and consequently they'll run fast breaks all day. Now is the time I'm going to call you unto God, because I'm finished preaching or whatever I was doing this time. That time is over.